So my name is Rich Tu. I'm an artist, designer, creative thinker. I'm also a podcast host. I host a podcast called First Generation Burden, and do a lot of other stuff in between.
Yeah, so what do you do, basically?
Right.
Yeah.
So I am, aside from a designer, an artist, I'm also a VP of design at MTV. And that's currently what I do, and it's a whole lot of fun.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah.
MTV, that's huge.
It is huge.
Yeah. So you've worked with a lot of different companies, actually, prior to MTV. You've done magazines. You've done...
Right.
A lot of like sports and clothing.
Right.
So tell us about some of the big projects that you've worked on before.
Sure. So aside from MTV, where I currently am, I previously also worked at Nike. I've worked at a few different agencies, working with several clients like American Express, Verizon. I worked on Hamilton, the musical. I've worked on Coca-Cola. I've also worked for other sneaker companies, like Who Shall Not Be Named. And I've done a whole lot of things. Worked with Slam Magazine, XXL, have a good history in a lot of youth culture and pop culture and sports. So a lot of that stuff is really just based in my desire to create energetic visuals, as well as create and be a creative that is a problem solver for right now. And a lot of that is, you know, that takes a lot of time to build that sort of portfolio as well as that sort of skill set and ability. But fortunately, I've had enough time to do that.
That's amazing, man. You've done a lot. You have a huge long list of things that you've done
trying,
and achievements. What's your ethnicity?
Sure. I'm a first generation Filipino American. My parents came from the Philippines. I was born here in the United States. And they came to the U.S. when they were about 20 years old. They hadn't known each other, but they left the Philippines in the late 60s. They've actually been American longer than they've been Filipino.
Right.
So they raised me and my sister and our family to have good values, and that's something that I still carry with me to this day.
That's awesome. So do you how does that play in the part of being an Asian American Filipino designer in New York?
I think about that all the time. I think about the melting pot and also the diaspora effect on my life and my career constantly, because like you're saying, being Asian, being a New Yorker, originally from New Jersey, being a creative, all of that mixes up in one big mental and physical stew, and it outputs itself into all the stuff that I've had the privilege of working on. So my culture, even if I don't ultimately think about it, if it's not the front of my mental cortex, it actually does bleed itself into the work.
That's awesome. Yeah, it's nowadays it's hard to find faces like ours in media, and
that's so true.
It's great what you're doing, because you're on a huge platform and people can see like, hey, he's Filipino or he's Asian,
right,
and he's a designer. Maybe I could do it too.
Right. Yeah. I definitely believe in that. I think it's so important to see a version of yourself doing what you potentially want to do.
Yeah.
And I've had the privilege of both seeing those faces. Of course, there's a representation problem across the board, so I didn't always see those faces. One face that I saw that changed my perspective was Dante Bosco, when he played Rufio in Hook, right?
Yeah.
So seeing someone that's Filipino, that's brown, that's killing it, and also is a badass, and they are in the ring with Robin Williams, and making Robin Williams, who's also a badass, second guess himself, at least in the movie, that resonates, especially when you're a little kid, seeing that Asian face. So now I've had the pleasure of being in a similar position where, on a smaller scale, not a big screen scale, but I get to talk to young designers, young creatives who are Asian and also who are up and coming and are probably looking for an example so that they can take it even farther.
That's great. Yeah, no, that's definitely great. And speaking of, inspiring young designers, you just did the biggest project ever for Nike. So
biggest project ever. If we could just put those in quotes, biggest project ever for Nike, let's call it.
So tell us a little bit about this project, and we would love to see what it's all about.
For sure. So I had the privilege, like Poon is saying, I had the privilege on working on a Nike sneaker. And also, again, like I was saying, I've also previously worked at the organization, which was an amazing experience. So being able to come back to that company in this capacity is really, feels very home for me. And also, I've been a lifelong sneakerhead since I was a kid.
Oh, word.
Yeah, so I've told this story a couple of times in a couple of different forums, but I still have the first Air Force One that I ever bought with my own money in a box in my parents' house back in New Jersey.
Yeah, yeah.
It was an 11 and a half black and white canvas Air Force One. I bought it in Livingston Mall in New Jersey.
Wow.
At a Foot Action. And the thing that resonated with me as a kid or changed my perspective was, this is a bit of a deep cut, Vinny from Naughty by Nature.
Naughty by Nature,
the hip hop group classically from New Jersey, mm-hmm. East Orange, represent, Chilltown. So, Vinny comes out of a Foot Action when I'm just a kid, like 11 years old, right? And he walks out with a bunch of boxes, like in his hands, and bags in his hands, also carrying it up here. And I'm thinking, whoa, that's Vinny from Naughty by Nature, hip hop hooray, holy shit. And then I'm thinking also, wow, I've never seen so many sneakers on one person. And he didn't look like he had friends
with
him at the time. Right. He didn't have a posse.
Oh, wow.
He was just rolling
just
rhymes.
Solo.
Just and, solo dolo.
Oh, man.
So that always resonated with me, and it kind of helped seed the sneakerhead mentality in me.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah, and getting back to these are the first gen Air Max 270 Reacts.
Nice.
So there you go. Check this out on the heel. First in gen, popping off. So I had the great opportunity of joining the Nike Cultivator program. And what that is, it's a group of influencers within certain cities that get to work on specific sneaker models and tell their story through sneakers, which is something that I've had the privilege of doing before in my life, but never in a real personal way. And like I said before, I'm a podcast host. I'm a first generation Filipino American, and I host a podcast called First Generation Burden, which is a series of conversations with immigrants and the children of immigrants. And I've been doing it for about 3 years. It's available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, a lot of those platforms where you get podcasts. And it's been a passion of mine to uplift the immigrant voice, specifically in the past few years. So Nike was very receptive, and Cultivator were very receptive to the idea of telling that story through shoes, through my lens, which was a great blessing. And aesthetically, this is based in oxidized metal. So for the viewer, oxidized metal is something, it's an organic phenomenon that occurs in a lot of countries. So if you're in the Philippines, or if you're in Brazil, or if you're in Mexico, or any other place that's beautiful, right? You'll see a lot of these orange and green and teal tones, and also the blending of those things.
Okay.
And that's really that's a very natural thing to happen to a lot of older buildings. And in New York, specifically, the Statue of Liberty is composed of oxidized metal because it's oxidized copper.
Okay.
So as a connection point, a lot of immigrants that come to America are familiar with that aesthetic. And then one of their touch points of what this country could be, the Statue of Liberty, is also that. So
that's really cool.
To connect those dots.
That's cool that Nike even embraces the fact of like immigration and sneakers combined together and make it a cool trend.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's awesome, man.
Also, this is available for a limited time only. Just letting the viewer know.
Okay.
You can only buy it until September 1st.
Oh, wow.
On Cultivator's website, that's cultivator.co /NYC_rich_TU CLTVTR.co/NYC_rich_TU So that's a very long website, but it goes right to Nike.com.
Okay.
And you can buy them there. And all the proceeds that I'm personally making from the shoe are going to the ACLU to benefit immigrant rights.
Oh, wow. That's amazing.
Yeah. I just want to be able to give back.
That's commendable. Definitely.
Yeah.
And what is your Instagram and website? Where can people find you?
So my Instagram handle is rich_TU, RICH_TU. Don't forget the underscore. There's some guy in London who has rich too, one word. So tell him to kick rocks and give that to me. So my website is also rich2.com. I haven't updated it with the most updated work, but you can see some previous Nike work from a couple years ago on there, as well as a variety of other creative projects that I've worked on.
That's dope. And then my last question to you is, what kind of inspiration can you give young and up and coming designers, or just, you know, anybody who wants to get into the business of just being a creative?
Sure. The biggest piece of advice that I can give, and I don't even really believe in advice, is that in the very beginning, it's okay to be terrible at what you do. It's okay to an extent, rather, because you're ultimately gonna have to learn. You're ultimately going to have to engage in different forms that you've never engaged in before. You're going to be put under the test, and they're going to apply pressure, and they is going to be a lot of different forces. So if you want to be a creative in a very highly competitive space, which this happens to be in, which Poon happens to be in, you just be ready to be not so great in the very beginning, but then be receptive to change, be receptive to learning, and be receptive to bettering yourself, because in the long run, there is really only an upward trajectory.
That's great, man. Thank you so much. Thank you for being a part of this interview. I really appreciate it. And any last words?
I appreciate you. Thank you for coming by, Poon.
Dope, thank you.